Heidi is enrolled in the Graduate Certificate in Language Teaching with Technology that is offered by the Division of Continuing Education at the University of Colorado Boulder. Everybody should be able to see my screen right now. And it's a 12 graduate credit program, and we have a number of summer courses. And the next summer course that is starting right now is the Language and Technology Foundation course. It is a 3-credit-hour course. It starts Saturday. The deadline to sign up for this course is really today, if you want to make sure to have course access by Saturday. It is a foundation course, and if you want to get the certificate, you will need to complete this course. It's offered once a year. Through this course, we talk about high-level technology integration. We talk about the SAMR model. We talk about copyrights. We talk about accessibility and universal design. We learn how to use Google Drive in depth, and we also learn how to use VoiceThread. So, the next course will be the Digital Games and Language Learning course, and it's an 8-week course that starts July 1st, and it's entirely dedicated to digital games in the language classroom. And finally, the last summer course is a course for teachers who want to improve their own command of the target language. We don't always have a chance to practice our own command of Spanish or French or German or the language that we teach. And so this course pairs you up with a language partner, and you work on your own goals. You pre-establish goals, and then you meet twice a week with a language partner to work on your own proficiency. So these are the summer courses. I will, when I share the recording of this presentation by Heidi, I will also share these slides. If you have any questions, you are welcome to email me, or I think email is probably the easiest way. All right, so Heidi, with that, I'm going to stop sharing my screen, and I'm going to ask you to share your screen, Heidi.
Okay, so today we're going to learn about digital storytelling in the World Language Classroom, and my presentation title is called Tell Me a Story. And to give you guys a little bit of introduction to who I am Heidi Trude, and I have my Master's of Education. I graduated from Sweetbriar College with my degree in French in 2007, and then earned my Master's in Education from the University of Mary Washington in 2009. I just finished my 9th year teaching French at Skyline High School in Front Royal, Virginia. And I am now a student in the certificate program at the University of Colorado Boulder. And I'm also the 2017 Region 4 Virginia Teacher of the Year. And if you want to connect with me, feel free to use my email. It's down there at the bottom. It's just my name, heidi.trude@colorado.edu. And I'm really excited to share with you guys today. So if we go to the next slide, I also made, in case you need it or you want to share it with anybody else, this is the link to today's presentation, as well as all of my other resources that I have available for you all. So you'll get that, or you've already received that in the email that Advij sent out. So feel free to share it with whoever. I have no issues with you all sharing it with others in your department, in your school divisions. Please feel free to share. I am one who is very big on sharing. And then we'll go on to slide 4, which, as I call it, is chapter 1. Which is digital storytelling. So we're gonna get started with the basics of digital storytelling and look a little bit about what it is, why I kind of chose this project for my technology integration project, and then kind of how I broke it down into my actual project that I did with my students. So to start off with, digital storytelling allows all students to have a voice in the world language classroom. And this was just my basis. This was actually when I wrote my paper. This was my opening sentence in my paper. And it truly was what drove me to come to this idea, because I was looking for a project in which I could find something that would allow each of my students to have a voice, to tell their story in a way that was personal to them and it was meaningful. So I came upon this idea, let's do a digital storytelling project. So why it's so powerful is because, and this is the next slide, the power of it, it's multimodal, okay? So that means the students, they're writing it first, then they're speaking, they're also listening. It incorporates all their skills. It's also giving the students a voice. for the first time, for many of them, this is the first in my class that they heard themselves speaking this language and heard it back to themselves. Usually, yes, we speak in class all the time, but to them, it was different when they actually heard their voice being played back to them, telling them their own story. So it was really powerful for them to feel that I can tell a personal tale about myself. I get to share it with my classmates, other teachers I brought in as well, and it was just very powerful to them. And it allows the students to create meaning because they're writing about something personal. And when it's not just one of those prompts from the textbook, it's something that's actually important to them. It's providing them with meaning. They're going to become more engaged in it and also more interested in the project in the long run. So that was why I decided to go with this digital storytelling project. And it turned out to be phenomenal, though there were some bumps along the road, which I will explain later on. But for the most part, it was a fabulous basis for my project. So we go to slide number 7. What was my actual project? So in the tools class, which is the class through the certificate program, which is 5:50:30, we were asked to form a project, basically a culminating project for the class, which we call our TIP project or technology integration project. And me being one who was already quite proficient, I would say, in technology, already being a Google certified educator level 1 and level 2 and a trainer, Edvige told me that I should challenge myself to do something that I haven't done as much and really to push myself to hit that redefinition level in the model. So I was like, okay, what do I want to do? So I decided to settle on digital storytelling, and then I came up with this project. And in my project, my students were working on a way to create a digital story, and their topic was the passé. We were finishing up a unit on the passé composé, and for the project, they had to create a story in which they described their summer vacation, and it could be last summer, it could be any summer, just any summer vacation of theirs that they wanted to describe this amazing and awesome vacation that they went on. But we weren't going to jump right into the Adobe Spark project right away. We had a series of steps that we went through to accomplish our goals with that project. So if we go to slide number 8, we'll kind of take a look at the project bit by bit. So we'll look at what my assignment was for them. We'll take a look at my learning objectives. We'll take a look at what 21st century skills and the SAMR model that this project covered, as well as what it covered in the actual standards. So the assignment was pretty basic. To start off with, when we started was my students had been working with the passé composé for about 2 weeks prior to being assigned this project. And then they were going to come up with a story. And I told them first, you had to come up with a narrative. And I did provide them with a planning guide with some questions to consider, as well as vocabulary that they could incorporate into the narratives. And then from there, I provided them with feedback and they were allowed to work with their classmates. And then once they completed that, we moved on to our next step, which was our storyboard template, which I will show you guys that in a little bit. And then we moved on once their template was approved, and we'll talk more about the template. We then moved to the Adobe Spark video, which my students had already used it before in other assignments. However, we hadn't taken it to this level in which they would actually be adding in the music, adding in their own voice, their narration, basically doing a full scale. When you see the projects at the end, then I'm going to hope it cooperates and functions nicely with us today. If not, you can go back and see the links. I've included examples in this presentation as well as in one of the other links I've included. It links to even more student examples of what these final products actually look like, and they are phenomenal what the students create. So then they would go to Adobe Spark, create from Spark. And from Spark, after that, they would then share their link with me through Google Classroom. And then the goal was on the last day of our project, we would share the projects in class and each of the students would watch each other's present it. And then to take it a step further, we were going to share our projects. I have a partner. And our goal would be that the plan was with our sister school in France, and they were also writing stories that they would share with our class. Now we'll get more into all of that in a little bit with how it actually worked, but that's the assignment in a nutshell. And then, so That's already the assignment with slide 9. And that was just how we went through creating the story. And I'll describe each step of the process in a few more slides. We'll look at that. So if we look at our learning objectives that I created for my students, my first learning objective was that the students would be able to use the passé composé to describe what they did on vacation. They would also be able to differentiate between the use of the helping verbs avoir and être using the passé composé. And finally, the students would learn how to narrate past events and describe what they did in the past. And again, prior to creating this project, they had already been given experience with passé composé, so they were quite familiar with it and had had plenty of time to practice and get feedback before jumping into the project. In terms of looking at our 21st century skills, I focused on 3 areas for this project. The first one being collaboration, which I'm sorry, I put communication up there. I'll fix that. Should be collaboration, which in this one, the students were collaborating with each other in creating their digital stories. And in addition, the collaboration also occurred when my students and the students at our partner school, when they were providing feedback to each other. In terms of critical thinking, the students would need to carefully analyze their choices of images and music to incorporate in their stories, and they would also need to ensure that their choices reflect the message they are trying to convey in their stories. And finally, the last piece was innovation, and the students would be creating their digital stories using Adobe Spark video, and the students will also be sharing and communicating with native French speakers at our partner school. And then that led us to our SAMR level, which for this project, I determined our SAMR level to be at the redefinition level, because at this point, my students were no longer just writing a story. Through Adobe Spark video, they were able to create a multimodal presentation to be shared with their peers in France. And by adding the element of the presentation to their stories and presenting it to their peers in France via the Google Hangout, this lesson takes on an entirely different meaning. And the students' learning is being redefined through the use of the technology tools. And in terms of our actual standards, we looked at the topic of communication and communities. In terms of communication, with this project, my students will convey meaning and they will understand the past events through the 3 modes of communication being interpersonal, interpretive, and presentational. The students focused on interpreting the material found on the planning guide, and in their groups, they communicated with each other, and finally, the students presented their vacation to the class through their digital storytelling project. And why I chose communities was because they were sharing their stories with their peers in France, and it's taking learning outside of the classroom and sharing it beyond the 4 walls of my classroom. So that's kind of the standards and the objectives that led up to the project. So if we go to slide 13, we'll look at the whole process that I used in setting this up. So the process was kind of in 3 parts. So you had part 1, which was the narrative. Then from the narrative, which they received the planning guide, which I'll show you all an example of on the next slide, we moved from there. Then we moved to the storyboard piece, which they found that probably that was one of the most helpful pieces that they found, and that's some of the feedback that my students gave me was having the storyboard really help them instead of having to spend so much time sitting at Adobe Spark and just looking at the program and not knowing what picture am I going to put in, what do I write here. It really became a time saver having that storyboard where they actually pretty much had it done, and then it was just a matter of plugging and chugging it into Adobe Spark to create their final project, which was their digital story. So if we look at piece number 1, which is the narrative, it was based off of the planning guide, which is on slide 14. And I basically provided my students with this photocopy, which I scanned in here for us. And it was just very basic, gave them some questions that they could consider if you were describing an exceptional vacation. So it gave them some questions, things like, where did you go? What did you do? Who went with you? What did you see? Why was this vacation special? Kind of just giving them questions to think about. For some of them, they had a clear idea from the start. They knew that their favorite vacation was going to Disney World and that they saw Mickey Mouse. Some of them knew it was a trip to New York City.
Some students had it very simple. It was just a trip to their grandparents' house. But again, it was what was unique and what created meaning for each of the students. But for those who really needed that extra support, I provided them with this document. And in addition, I also had supplementary vocab that they could choose to use if they wanted to. Some of them were content and just used the vocab that was in their textbook. Others branched out even further, but again, it was up to the students and what would make meaning for the students and be most meaningful to them that I wanted them to go at, because the goal of this was as to share their voice and to present their story to an audience. So again, I let them choose a lot with this aspect of it. And then once they wrote their narratives, they brought them to me. I looked over them, provided them feedback through the Google Doc, and then they were allowed to start on their storyboard, which I put in a screenshot on slide 15. And basically, this again was another Google Doc, and it just says creating your digital story. And I've since used this storyboard template for my other projects that I've had my other students do as well as this class. Also went and they did a final project as a digital story as well, because they loved it so much. But basically, the template is very simple. I just told them you complete the storyboard before you get to use Spark. It's pretty much so I know that you're ready to go and you're not just going to jump on there and be wasting our class time by sitting there and playing with the tech toy, which we know sometimes giving our students a new technology toy, they are going to spend a lot of time playing on it, which playing is great. I'm not going to say it's not great. It is really good. And what I did with them when I actually first introduced them to Spark is that I allowed them one day after a quiz, I was like, hey, you guys are gonna go on this website. I want you to create an account and then just play. So giving them that playtime at first really helped. And they're like, well, what do we do, mademoiselle? I'm like, just play. Try out the features on Spark, see what it can do, see what you can do with it, because we're gonna be doing a project later on and I kind of want you to understand the tool before we actually start with the real project. So they had already had their playtime. Now we are into the project. So back to our template, very basic. I told them, you're just gonna fill this in as if this is basically your rough draft. So they had to put in their title page, their name of their story, their name, and then they would go page by page, making sure they were including an image and their narration for each page of their story. And then at the bottom, I asked them, for your music selection, even if you don't know what that title would be of your music. And the nice thing is in Adobe Spark, they provide you with lots of free music options. So I told the kids, just use what's in Spark. It's a lot easier that way, which they did. But I told them, make sure kind of the music you pick, make sure it goes with your story. And if your story is this happy story of you all going to Disneyland, you probably don't want to pick a horror soundtrack to play in the background. That just wouldn't be a good idea. But if you're writing a story like Dark Stormy Night, you probably want some music that has a little bit of a scary tone to it and not like a happy stroll in the park. That wouldn't go together well. So I'm like, as long as you can justify your reasoning, then it was fine. And that's what I asked them to do there. Just if you're not sure, tell me the type of music and justify why you did that. So then after they did that step, and that was again approved by me, they would move on to the next step, which would be the actual creation of their project. And again, before they moved on, I provided the feedback so they were good to go. So the final step in their creation phase was creating their video, which is an Adobe Spark video. It is a free program. And how I had my students log on, and I did include a link at the end of the presentation to log on to Spark. It's very easy. It is free. All of my students logged on with their Google account, so it was very easy to do. We just logged on with our school Google accounts, and I don't have an issue with the age of my students because all of mine are over the age of 12, so we had no issues logging anyone on. However, if you have students that are under the age of 12, then it is an issue because you have to be at least 12 years old to have Spark, so you might want to work with your ITRT at your school if that is the case. And some suggestions might be to create a class Gmail they can use and then just assign them all or have one email they use and then you're the owner of it. There are some workarounds that you can do if that's the case. but we created our accounts, and then they got on there. And then they had our days in class to start working on creating their video. But we kind of had a little hang up along the way here. Completely unpredicted, out of nowhere, we got a big snowstorm. And I'll talk more about that later on, but that did create quite some problems in completing the project. And as some people know who are listening in, I live in a very rural area. And as we've noticed already, technology and Wi-Fi can be a little spotty in some of these rural areas. So I couldn't assume that my students would be able to finish this project at home. I had to give them the time in class where we had the devices, which in my school, we are completely one-to-one. In my classroom, not our whole school is one-to-one, but we do have a one-to-one set of Chromebooks here in our classroom. But I couldn't assume that my students, A, had the technology at home, B, had the internet capability, so I couldn't trust that they could complete this project at home. It had to be one that was completed in class. And then we get the dreaded snowstorm, which really messes things up. And I'll explain that later on, but it didn't stop me. So they would create their video in Spark. When they finished it in Spark, I made the easiest way. There's a couple ways they can share it with you when they're done. You can either, I decided my one way was have them, I created a sheet in Google Sheets, listed each student's name, and then had them share their link to their Spark when you create Spark. You can choose if you want to download the video or if you just want to create a shareable link. I had them create shareable links this first time. When I have later gone on further in the project and tried more projects with digital storytelling with Spark, I have had the students also download the videos and attach them into Google Classroom. That way, if the internet fails, I still have their project and we can still watch it, because we never know when internet will fail at school. So I decided that might be the safer route to go. Instead of having them just share a link, then I actually have that copy of the file of their video. So that was the video creation phase. And then I did assess my students at the end of their project. I created a rubric, and I know it's very, very small on the slides here, so if you want a copy of this rubric, I am more than happy to share the rubric with you all. I am more than happy to share copies of the planning guides, copies of my template for the storyboard, anything like that. If you just shoot me an email and say, hey, can you share this with me, or anything else that you want, I will gladly share it all with you. Just please let me know. But they were assessed on this, and I did give the students a copy of it ahead of time so they knew what I would be looking for. And I was looking at things for their content, their comprehensibility, their accuracy, their organization, and the effects and creativity of their digital story project. And again, they knew all of it ahead of time. So that's what led up to the creation of the project, which leads us to chapter 3, the effects of the project. So chapter 3. The effects of the project, meeting the learning objectives, and the student's reaction. And then to slide 19. So the effects of the project, and again, student reaction, so the learning objectives. I completely feel with my project that we did meet our learning objectives. I feel, and based not only on their scores on this project, but also on their scores of their overall test with the passé composé in comparison to previous years, I feel that my students actually had a better understanding of passé composé than in previous years. They also, I felt that they had a better grasp on differentiating between the use of the helping verb avoir versus être through all the practice we had had. I think it made more sense to them because they were talking about something that was personal to them. It was something that was making, they were talking about their own vacations. And then at the end of the year, and we'll talk about it in a little bit, one of my favorite projects besides this one that I did with my students was our final project story, which they created an original story of their own called It Was a Dark and Stormy Night, which that one literally, they blew my mind away, some of them, and what they created on that one. But overall, I would say it was a success in accomplishing our learning goals. And in terms of the student reactions, this class is one that sometimes they were very engaged, in class and sometimes they weren't, but through this project, they all were engaged with the project, and we're going to talk about some of their thoughts and comments in a minute. But this was one where I saw learning happening. They were using the language. They were really working hard with it because I think they realized that this is something I'm going to be showing to my classmates. This is something that other people are going to see, and I really wanted them to have pride about what they were doing, to put that pride into their project, which is what they really came out, and they really did that. So I was very impressed with that part of it. And then if we go to slide number 20, I did take, while we were working on the project, I used my iPhone, and we took some pictures of the students actively engaged in the project, and this was them working on their templates. And as you can see from their faces, they're very happy. They're very actively engaged. They were laughing, carrying on with each other, comparing their stories, seeing where people were going on vacation, what vacations were fun. And then they were like, well, I want to go there. And like the conversations were just, it was contagious, the energy that was present in the room. And then slide 21 shows them more. And then this day, they were actually collaborating more, looking over each other's work, kind of looking over their storyboards and their narratives and getting it to the point where they're ready for me to review it. And again, you can all see they're actively engaged, they're actively working, and I am going around and providing feedback as well during this time. And then if we go to slide 22, while they were working, I also went around and started snapping pictures of them actually working within Adobe Spark, just so you all could kind of get a sense of what the story creation looked like. So this is one of the students' stories, and she was describing her vacation and her trip to New York, and this was one of her opening sentences. And she said, "J'ai visité New York." I visited New York. And then she included her picture with herself and her two siblings who also take French, and one of them also happened to be in that class as well. So it was really interesting that both of the siblings chose different vacations as their most memorable. So that was kind of cool and fun. But then she went on and continued to describe over on slide 23. She showed a little bit more of what she did, which this one she showed us going to FAO Schwartz, the toy store. So what did they do? They went to New York, and well, you're a kid. What's the first thing you want to do when you go to New York City? Is you want to visit the big toy store, FAO Schwartz. So she then described their visit there, what she and her siblings did, what they bought, what they saw, and then she continued on with her story. Another example of what one of my said on slide 24 was another one. She did a simple story describing her trip to the beach. She included a beach picture, and I told the students, if you don't have your own photos to include, it's okay. Like, some of the students put in their own personal photos. Some of them didn't have the capability to get photos from home, or they couldn't get their parents to share the photos, etc. And I told them, if you don't have the personal photos, it's not a problem, because the beauty with Adobe Spark is that they have a whole photo gallery that you can choose from. And if they don't have a photo there, you can take a URL and you can put it into Adobe Spark as well. So if the students say, well, I don't have pictures, it's not a problem. It's not the end of the world. This one, the beach, that was just a stock picture from Adobe Spark that she used because she didn't have the capabilities to take pictures when she was at the beach or a way to share them to school. So they don't have the picture. It's not an issue. And then on slide 25, this student again, this was another student. They also went to the beach, and again, the student chose a picture that wasn't from Spark, which that's still okay too, and then they went on and described their trip to the beach. So it's kind of what it looks like when they're creating a story, and then what my students said about it, like, they were so excited, and their comments, like, I didn't know what to expect. You never know kind of sometimes what high school students are going to say about projects, and they're kind of like, sometimes they're weird about it. But I gave them what I made was a simple Google form and just asked them at the end of the project, hey, can you guys fill this out? I just want to know how I can make this project better for your classmates for next year. So, and then I gave them the opportunity, like, to rate it, what were their favorite parts, and to answer some questions. And some of the comments they said were that they liked getting to share about their vacation. It made learning grammar more fun. Another student said, Adobe Spark is really cool. I want to make more projects with it. Another one said, I was able to create and share a story, not only with my class, but to a bigger audience. How cool. Another student said, the project was a fun way to use the passé composé. And then Kirsten said, the project really helped me to understand the passé composé. I liked recording my voice too. And then finally, Adam said, coolest French project Miss Trude has had us do. I want to do more projects like this. So you can see that the students really bought into this project. Whether it was the multimodality of Adobe Spark and the whole digital storytelling process that made them, that just sparked their learning with it, or that it was just getting to talk about themselves. I'm not sure exactly what, and I can't pinpoint to what it was that really got them into this, but I then decided I'm going to do this with some other classes as well. Tried it with my French 1s, my French 3s, then did projects with it, as well as my level 4 and 5 class. I actually did a recreation of After Reading the Little Prince. They were given chapters and they had to recreate them. So that's one example I did include of one of their recreated scenes of The Little Prince. That one is super fun. Like, I was really proud of that one too. But this has really been, just seeing the students buy into it has been awesome. Like, the buy-in, once they, like, they are very hesitant at first when you tell them you're going to be recording your voice, you're going to be sharing this with your classmates, they kind of freak out. Okay, they don't kind of freak out, they do freak out. They're like, I don't want to record my voice. I'll sound stupid. I don't want people to hear me. I don't want people to see me recording myself. So what I did to combat those fears, we are fortunate enough to have our foreign language teacher workroom is right across from my hall. So I coordinated with my colleagues. And what we did was we turned it into a recording studio, basically. The students would go across with their Chromebooks. They would sit in there, they could do their recordings. When they were done, they would come back to my room and then they would send the next student over to record. It worked beautifully. And then some of the students were like, well, I was still really scared. I'm like, well, you can bring a buddy over there. And then some of them would bring a friend just to have that moral support. Some of them didn't want a single person near them when they were recording. It was actually quite funny to watch some of their reactions. Then they'd bring it to me, well, do I sound okay? Do I sound stupid? Do I sound silly? Some of them are like, I think I sound like a child. I'm like, well, if it makes you guys feel better, listen to what I sound like when I do a recording, because I think I sound like a child sometimes. But the kids were all happy with it. Excuse me. And they found out it's really not that scary to go and record. Some of them even got really comfortable with it and decided to do different character voices as recording, which did get really interesting and did make it a lot of fun when we listened to them. But overall, I think they were really pleased with it and they had a lot of fun, which leads to chapter 4, my reflections on the project. So chapter 4, reflections, what worked, what didn't work, and the changes I would make. So the first thing, my biggest issue with this project, when I was putting it into place for my class for 5030, was an unexpected snowstorm. That was horrible, completely unplanned for, and I'm in an area where if we get just even a little bit of snow, we're out for a couple days. Well, this was multiple inches of snow, and then with ice on top of it, which meant we were out for almost a week of school. And missing a week of school on block scheduling, as some of you all know, is horrendous. And it was also a time where we were dealing with our standards of learning testing, so then that put more craziness into the schedule and changes happened. So by the time the 5030 class ended and this project was due, I didn't get to the point that I wanted to be at for the project. We were still in the creating the project phase and creating those stories through Spark. But I knew the kids liked it so much. I did want them to finish, and I did want to work with our partner schools still, because I knew they were also working on it. But I knew the hangout wasn't going to happen in March like I had initially planned. Things were going to get a little crazy in getting everything scheduled. So it was just a lot of patience on my part and patience on the school in France. We did have our hangout. However, it didn't go exactly as I had hoped, with each student being able to share their stories and with each the French student sharing theirs and my students sharing theirs. We were only able to share a couple just due to the fact that their schedule now was completely different and they were preparing for exams. So it didn't work exactly how I had wanted, but it set it up for the future that this is a project that we're going to continue on next year with my partner school, and we're going to take it to different levels and try different stories with different students and have them work more in partners doing this instead of the whole group coming together to do this story. So the snowstorm was a big issue, but other good things and reflections on slide 29. The success of the project, I would say overall it was a success. The students created beautiful narratives. The stories were wonderful, and it really got them speaking in the target language. They were reading in it when they were doing their narratives. They were listening, and then I even worked further and developed a listening comprehension activity that they were doing during each other's stories, which I found has helped a lot, and I've used it with my other classes as well. Because if you just have them sit there and listen to the presentations, some of the kids start tuning out. Some of them try to take out their devices. But I designed a form on Google that I had them complete for each story. And it was basically a way to provide peer feedback to their classmates about their stories. Like, what was your favorite part of the story? What could you do to improve your story? Just basic constructive criticism. And it really helped the students, I think, focus on being a good listener and being a good audience member at the same time. So that was some of the successes of the project, changes I would make. And as I thought about it more, and as I have incorporated more digital storytelling projects into my class, changes I would make possibly for the future: allow more time to have the project completed and allow for unexpected events like weather to occur and not to let that really sidetrack you. Another change I thought of was possibly having it be more of a collaborative project, have the students work in partners, and then they could create their original story as a pair and tell it kind of in the voice of two characters instead of just one, which you'll see I did that with my Little Prince project, and it works really well with the students going back and forth playing the roles of the different characters. That one was just really cool. Excuse me, but overall, I feel it was very successful, and it is something that I would like to do and continue to do with my students in the future. So if we look at taking it further, which is chapter 5, even more digital storytelling projects, because this project went so well, I wanted to do more because the kids liked it, and I figured if this class likes it and this class that I worked with was my class that has trouble liking things and doing projects and not getting as involved, if they were falling, like, hooked by it, then I knew my other students would easily be hooked by it. So I came up with some other topics for my different levels of French. And I mean, really, it's up to you all. You can pretty much create a story on any topic you want. But I just decided for each class as their final, I came up with a digital storytelling project. So the first one was for my level twos, which was the group that did this original project. And theirs was, it was a dark and stormy night. That's all I gave them, was the prompt. I did provide them again with a planning guide. I did provide them with a template, the story template that you guys have seen. And then they were off to create their story. I told them it could be scary if they wanted. It could turn out to be funny. It was their choice, and I'll show you guys an example of that. Another one I did for my level threes, working on various grammar tenses, we had, if I had $1 million, what would I do? And they had to write a story telling me what they would do if they had $1 million. Some of them really had a lot of fun with it and came up with really creative stories. Others were kind of like, I have no idea what I would do. So therefore, again, I provided them with that planning guide with some questions and things they could think about for those who need that scaffolding. It's there for them. The others, some just jump right in. Another example that we did was, again, with my level threes, was describing your future self. So I told them you had to think of yourself 20 years from now. Okay, what are you going to be like 20 years from now? And they had to describe their future selves and kind of create this project. But, well, in 20 years from now, I will be married. I'm going to have a family. Like, I'll have a successful job. Like, and they really had to think about their life. And for some of them, this was their first time that they had to think that way and think, well, what do I really want to be when I grow up? And it forced them to think not just about using the target language, but to think on a more personal level about themselves and their goals. Another project I did, and this one was with French 1, was the celebrity description project, very basic project, in which they pick a celebrity, and then using their adjectives and nouns, they are working on adjective agreement and noun agreement. They're just describing a celebrity, where they, their name, etc. So very basic project. And on that one was one I didn't have the students record because they were still learning and I felt they weren't quite ready to jump to the recording, but they were ready enough to create their narration and add in the music to get themselves ready for their final project. And for their French 1 final project, they had to create basically an autobiography about themselves and their likes, their dislikes, their families. Basically, I would call it an all about me presentation. So showing everything we've covered in French 1 kind of turned into a 1 to 2 minute little movie about themselves that they made using Adobe Spark. So that's some of the ideas I had, but literally, it's endless what you guys can come up with and what you can create, and it works across all languages. So pretty much any story idea will work, and we're going to try and see if we can play these. I don't know how well this is going to work, but if we want, we can give it a try. So you guys can kind of get an idea what one of them looks like. So Edwige, if you want to go ahead and go to slide 32. We can see what's going to happen just so everyone gets an idea of what this looks like. All right. Looks like it's loading for you guys.
C'était une nuit sombre et lugubre. J'ai été au lit quand j'ai entendu un bruit mystérieux. Je pensais que le bruit était ma sœur ou mon père au rez-de-chaussée. Mais je me doutais. Je regardais à mon horloge. C'était une nuit. Il faisait une tempête et j'étais timide. J'ai hurlé pour mes parents, mais ils ne répondaient pas. Ensuite, je me suis levé et j'ai rampé pour les escaliers. Quand j'ai descendu sur les escaliers, j'ai vu des taches de sang sur le mur. Et puis, j'ai vu des flaques de sang sur le plancher. J'ai hurlé encore pour ma famille, mais la réponse était silence. Ensuite, j'ai marché au rez-de-chaussée. Soudain, j'ai vu des traces de fourrure attachées de la scène. J'ai prouvé à appeler pour l'aide, mais quelque chose m'a frappé de dernière. J'ai regardé pour voir qu'est-ce que c'est, mais tout ce que j'ai vu, c'était les griffes d'un monstre. Et puis, je ne me rappelais pas. Je pensais qu'il était est passé à vous et vous avez souffert quand j'ai fait.
So that was an example of a French 2 project, and that was one of their finals. So that was done by my student. That was at the very end of French 2 that they made that one. I'm not, unless you guys want to see all the examples, I mean, you can watch them on their own time, but they go, actually, I'll have you look at one more. So Advise, if you want to click on French 1 final. So yeah, French 1 final, just so you guys kind of see the difference in how it works. So, this is French 1 final. This was done at the end of French 1.
Bonjour, je m'appelle Camarilla Dacon. J'ai 14 ans, je suis brune et grande. Je suis intelligent et gentil. J'aime chanter et manger. Dans ma famille, il y a un puissant. J'ai 5 frères et 3 sœurs. Mon frère s'appelle Zach. Il est petit et mignon. Ma mère s'appelle Cynthia, elle est grande et jolie. Mon père s'appelle Gary, elle est grand et amusant. À l'école, j'aime les maths et le français, mais je n'aime pas l'anglais. Quand il fait chaud, je mange, mais quand il fait froid, je n'aime pas jouer au foot. Quand il fait frais, j'aime jouer au basket et quand il pleut, j'aime regarder la télé. Pour le petit déjeuner, je mangeais une omelette et un croissant. Pour le déjeuner, je mangeais un hot dog et une pizza. Pour le dîner, je mangeais le collet et la soupe. C'est et je vais travailler. Au lycée, je vais étudier. Voici ma famille chien. Il s'appelle Carmelo. Voici mon chat, elle s'appelle Sparkles.
So, as you can see, that one was a little more basic, but to get the French ones to that level where they were confident enough to go and speak was really an accomplishment for them. So,
sounds good.
However you guys want to take it and run with it however you want. So that slide just has lots of examples, but if we go on to the slide for me, on my next slide, I have some resources for you all. So this is awesome free resources for digital storytelling. And if you guys, I have a whole nother presentation I linked there that I've given to FLAVA, which is the Foreign Language Association of Virginia, which has even more examples and more of my students' work and kind of ideas. And there's not just Adobe Spark. There video, there's Adobe Spark video, which is what I used. There's also Adobe Spark pages and posts, which I have examples to each of those and how you can use those in your classroom as well. So if that's something you're interested in and you don't want to just look at the video aspect of Adobe Spark, you can pretty much create almost like photojournalism through it. I've made some really cool brochure, not really a brochure, but a page which advertises one of my trips to France using Adobe Spark pages. And then Adobe Spark post is more like you use it more for making an infographic. So if that's something you like having your students do, I have information and tutorials all on that link for you as well. And then just some other additional resources on slide 35. For you guys, I put again another YouTube tutorial on using all of Adobe Spark. I did put the link to Adobe Spark itself there, so if you want to go on and access Adobe Spark, again, it's free. I cannot say enough good about it. It's like a treasure that a lot of people haven't found out about yet. They also do have an educator domain that you can log into with your Adobe account, and on the educator side of it, you do have access to more training materials. You have access to lesson plans that others have created as well, articles. So kind of to give you more ideas, if you need content ideas, et cetera, with using Spark, it's there. And then I also included some links to a couple really fascinating articles that when I was doing my TIP project, I also used these articles to kind of further my background in digital storytelling. So if you want to look at it a little bit further and get a more thorough understanding of digital storytelling. I have the three articles here that you all can check out. So that's pretty much what I have, an overview of my project, a look at some examples of it. But I'm totally open for questions now, and I do like to talk, and I saw that you guys said that in the chat room, which is cool. And yeah, I know, I'm hard to stop. So at this time, I'm going to turn it over to you all, and I want you guys to ask me anything that you want to ask me about digital storytelling, about the project, etc. And I see one question on there right now. I'm looking at the chat as well. Is there a time limit per video? No. None of us have ever been timed out on a video yet. So usually the kids aren't going to make a video that's super long, but we had some of ours, I know, in my Little Prince video, their video is almost 10 minutes long, and they had no issues making it. They also had lots of images. The one thing we did notice with it, if you have a lot of images, and when I say a lot, I mean like over like 30 some images, it does get a little slower, and it warns you when you get to a certain number. It'll be like, hey, we might not be able to have as good of transitions now. You might want to cut down your number. Like Adobe tells you, that's the awesome thing. It tells you, it gives you those warnings. And while you're waiting, another thing I like about it is that it gives the kids all these nice positive messages while you're waiting, like, hey, great ideas take time, or something cutesy to that effect. But no, in terms of time limit. Okay, I see another one. Did all the students have a computer to use in the classroom? Yes, they did. In my classroom, I am very fortunate. I have a one-to-one, I have Chromebooks for every student in my class that I house in my classroom. I got a grant to have those, so that's how we did that. And let's see, okay. All right, I'm streaming through. And how did they peer review? Okay, so basically what they did, they kind of read over, I am assuming whoever asked the peer review, you mean while they were creating their narrative, or do you mean while at the end when they were listening to them? So if you want to unmute yourself, ask a question that way too, guys.
In the different stages, so I guess both.
Okay, so while we were creating it, I basically just had them kind of read over, asking each other, does it make sense? I mean, obviously, they're not as good at catching the grammar mistakes, but they kind of were catching the general idea. And it was the first time they kind of started peer reviewing things. And while they were reviewing them, no, not all the times were they speaking French, because they're still learning, and I couldn't expect them to stay in the language the whole time. And then let's see, I saw another one. Okay, partner school. Okay. So, partner school, how I established that was actually done through the Virginia Department of Education. We have an MOU, a Memorandum of Understanding, with the Académie de Reims in France, and we actually, literally just last month, our state superintendent, Dr. Stephen Staples, went over to France along with our state foreign language specialist, and they renewed the MOU with France for I don't know how many more years. So my partnership is renewed again, which is awesome. So you might want to, depending on where you're at, is that you may want to just check with your state Department of Education, and there's actually, or you can check with the French embassy and see if you can establish one that way if you're looking for someone in France. And then let's see, do I know if an MOU is common in other states? I don't know how common it is in the other states, if states have these type of agreements. I know here in Virginia, we have one. I know for our Spanish teachers, I do not believe they have one. We also have a partnership with Switzerland as well. We have it with France. We have one with Switzerland. I want to say we have one with other countries, but not Spanish countries. I want to say possibly Japan, but I'm not 100% sure on that one. And then let's see, scanning through these. Okay. issues with using personal pics, and is permission needed? So through our school technology, we already, that's one of the forms they sign. At the beginning of the year is we have the photo agreement, technology agreement, all of that, that gives permission to the students to use those and to have things published. I also have a form that I have my students fill out at the beginning of the year saying that there is a chance that some of your work may be shown in presentations. Do you grant permission for this, et cetera? So that's taken care of that way. And then let's see. Other questions. How many class days did I dedicate to each video project? And that also varies depending on the length of the project. So for their final project, the one that we saw, it was the dark and stormy night, they had a week. Most of them, they would have a week or less. And on block, we're on a 90-minute block schedule. So literally, if you're not on block, it's like double of what a 45-minute class would be. So yeah, a week, 5 class days. Yep. Other questions, guys? I haven't gone through the whole chat stream, but feel free, unmute yourselves. You can talk to me instead of just sending me text messages. Anything. If you don't know how to unmute, just hit your microphone button next to your name.
Heidi, did you use English to describe what you needed to do, what the students needed to do?
Yeah, when I explained the project to them?
Yes.
Yes. I did explain it to them in English, especially when you're incorporating technology into your class. I would encourage you to use your directions in English to make sure that everybody is clear. However, if you look at some of my handouts, like the planning guide is all in French. Like, and that was back earlier in the slides. All their planning guides would be in French, but when explaining the technology and what they would do with the technology, I did that part in English.
Gotcha.
Other questions?
Hi, Heidi, can I ask a question?
Absolutely, I don't know who I'm talking to, but I can answer your question.
Okay, my name is Glenn Cake, and I'm teaching high school French in Eastern Canada.
Awesome.
Really enjoyed your presentation today.
Thank you
so much.
And I again apologize for all the tech issues when we prepped it. It was beautiful. So I feel bad, guys, that I'm literally sitting down in my basement. Yeah, it's kind of lonely in the basement right now, but that's where the router is. So
okay. It's
all good. But go ahead with your question, Glenn.
Yeah, the question, I've been using a program called Photo Story 3 for Windows.
Yeah.
The last 3 or 4 years. And you know, I think I finally found a replacement thanks to your presentation today, because what I like about Photo Story for Windows is that it can be saved locally to a computer.
Mm-hmm. So
you don't have to depend upon the internet connection for these stories to play.
Yeah. So you can, once you create it in Spark, you can download it to an MP4 file, which is really nice too. So once you make it, which I did use Photo Story way back in the day, that was one of the things in one of my tech classes, not through the certificate program, that I had just taken another tech class. And that was one tool they showed us. But then when I started playing with Adobe Spark, and that was actually, I found it through another class that I had taken. I just kind of stumbled across it and I was like, ooh, I like this. And then I just ran with it with Advija's class, and I have fallen in love with it. So hopefully you guys are going to fall in love with it too. And let's see, am I the only French teacher at my school? Yes, I am. I am the only French teacher, so I get all levels. I usually have multiple classes within one, like I'll have one block that might be a level 3, 4, 5 class. I might have I've had it as crazy as a level 1 with 3s and 4s in there before. So it can get a little crazy and challenging, but I do the best that I can. And then I see another question was, would you recommend this kind of project for elementary students? I would say yes, you could do things for elementary students with digital storytelling. You could make it even more basic for them. of them doing something very simple, like with the language. If they're learning, say, maybe the family, they could do something as simple as, this is my mom, this is my dad, this is my sister, this is my brother. You could do very basics with the language with them. I think it's, but your challenge with the elementary students would be, again, getting them the access to the Adobe Spark. What you could do in that case, probably a very simple workaround, is you go ahead and just log yourself in on each of their devices, since they obviously, and then you would just have all of them working off of your account for an elementary teacher. Other questions, guys? Feel free to jump on, unmute yourself. Anything is fine. It doesn't have to be about this. It can be about anything else, my partner school, anything.
Everybody, you also have Heidi's email, so you're welcome to email her if you want to ask more questions about the partner school. Finding a partner school is a bigger discussion. This is something we discuss in LGTC 5040.
And you guys can also connect with me on Twitter too. My Twitter handle is up there. I am really active on Twitter, so if you want to hit me up on Twitter, that's fine too. And my Twitter handle is just my name, htrude07. And if you hear my dog whining right now, I'm really sorry. He's super cute though, but he's whining.
All right. Well, I think we're good with questions. Thank you very much for attending this webinar. We had great attendance today with 29 people.
That's awesome.
250 people registered for this webinar. So I think it's wow. A good topic. This was a great project. Thank you so much, Heidi.
You are so welcome.
And if you have any questions about the program, please email me. And if you have any questions about Heidi's project, just go ahead and email her. Thank you, everybody.